Great to have you guys here, and what a beautiful, beautiful, I can't really say fall day, although it feels like fall, but what a beautiful late, late summer day. Fall is right around the corner, so yeah, supposed to warm back up. So for those of you who still want a little bit more of summer, I think we're back in the mid-80s this week, so you'll still have a little bit more of that to go. You know, I did a Google search the other day on the topic I'm going to talk about, self-centeredness. And I was surprised when I typed in self to find over 30 different headings under the category of self. Self-actualization, self-analysis, self-assertion, self-awareness, self-confidence, self-control, self-defense, self-determination, self-development, self-discovery, self-enrichment, self-esteem, self-expression, self-fulfillment, self-help, self-identity, self-image, self-improvement, self-indulgence, self-love, self-realization, self-reliance, and self-respect. So, we are a very self-conscious society. I was born in 1966. And I was born in the middle of what they call the Me Generation. The Me Generation officially refers to a decade, really, of those born between 1965 to 1975. And they are recognized for their self-absorbed traits. But I am certain that we can add many, many others to that list as well. Because Americans are preoccupied with self. We are. But that should be of no surprise to any of us in here today. For 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 through 2 says this, "You may as well know this, Timothy, that in the last day it is going to be very difficult for you to be a Christian, for people will love only themselves and their money. They will be proud and boastful, sneering at God, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful to them, and just thoroughly bad." He said, Paul said, in the last days it's going to be tough to be a Christian, because people will be in love with themselves and with their things. We've been looking at confronting our culture over the last 2 weeks, or 4 weeks, excuse me, and how to live counter to what the culture says. It is a culture, I might add, that lives primarily for self. There are three forms of self-expression that are driving the culture right now. They might already be listed for you on the back of your bulletin, so turn over there and follow along in your outline if you would like to. Three of them. Number one, individualism. Individualism says this, others don't matter. Two, secularism is driving the culture today, big time. And secularism says God doesn't matter. And number three, narcissism. And narcissism is all that matters is me. And let's go through those for just a quick bit, because that is in fact what is pushing the culture and what is pressuring all of us who live within this culture. First, there's individualism. Individualism says, I got to do what's best for me. And the model of individualism, is this. To each his own, do your own thing. Do you, boo. Do you. Just do you. And individualism has been driving our culture for some time. But, as I said, for some time, and it has been around for some time. Frank Sinatra had a song years back. I think it went something like, I did it my way, right? I did it my way. So it's been around for a while. Let me ask you, are people in our society becoming more considerate or more rude? More rude, for sure. Well, what's the cause behind that? Why is that? Have we changed? Why is that? What's the cause behind it? It's individualism. It's the idea that other people don't matter. What really matters most in life is me, how something makes me feel, how I look, what I think. It's about me. But the Bible said in Proverbs chapter 18, verse 1, that it is selfish and stupid to think only of yourself and to sneer at people who have sins. The NIV says, an unfriendly person pursues selfish ends. The NLT says, unfriendly people care only about themselves and they lash out to others, meaning they only think about what affects themselves, or that is at the top of their priority list. And that idea is driving a big portion of the culture in which you and I live today. Secularism is another form of self-expression that is driving our culture. Secularism says that God doesn't matter. Now, I've discovered over the years that for most secularists, it's not that they don't believe in God. It's just that they don't think God matters. They think he's irrelevant. Most people who live around you do not deny that God exists. Oh, we have a fringe few, but most people do not deny that God exists. They're just not interested in him, so they choose to ignore him because they think that God, they don't need him in their life. In Job chapter 21 and verse 14, it said, "Those who are evil say to God Almighty," God All-Powerful, "leave me alone, leave us alone. Don't bother us with your teaching." The Bible says that the wicked shun God. Leave me alone, because they don't care about his will for their lives. It's not that they deny God, they just don't think they need God. They don't want God. They basically say, "God, you stay on your side of the fence, and I'll stay over here on my side, and you don't bother me with your religion and your ideas and your thoughts, and I won't bother you with my problems. You handle the world, and I'll handle my own life. Thank you very much." The Bible said in Psalm chapter 10 and verse 4, "The wicked are too proud to seek God. They seem to think that God is dead." Prideful people feel that they don't need God anymore, okay? That is the epitome of pride. There is no room for God in their life. Question, can we become so full of ourselves that we don't think that there's room for God in our life? Can we do that? Absolutely. Absolutely we can. Listen to some of the book titles I came across this week in preparing for this message. And some of them were bestsellers in their day. "Recreating Yourself," "When All You Wanted Is Not Enough," "Looking Out for Number One," "How to Be Your Own Best Friend," "Pulling Your Own Strings," "Total Self-Confidence," "Trusting Yourself," "How to Keep Control of Your Life After 50. That was in the comic section. "How to Keep Control of Your Life After 50. Secularism and individualism basically say, "I don't need God. I don't need God and I don't need other people. All I really need is me. And so I certainly don't want anybody interrupting or cramping my lifestyle. So I don't really want anybody in my life." But the problem with a self-made person is that he or she ends up worshiping what they have elevated, in this case themselves, and therefore living only for themselves. Narcissism is the third expression that is driving our self-expression, that is driving our culture today. And it is a philosophy, in my opinion, that is permeating the culture right now. Narcissism basically says this: all that matters is me. Hey, and all I'm really interested in is myself and my goals and my dreams and my desire and my fulfillment and my happiness and my career and how I feel. And everything is evaluated by how does it make me feel or how does it make me look and what's in it for me. I was in a gas station the other day and I saw a sign, a classic sign of the times. It was, in fact, a sign that said, "Serve yourself." Now, if that is not an expression of our time, it describes our society right now. Live for yourself, serve yourself, do your own thing. And advertisers realize that that's where we're at. And so they play on this narcissism and this desire of the American public to think only of themselves. Burger King says, "Have it your way." McDonald's says, "We do it all for you." Commercial after commercial tells us that I'm the boss, I'm worth it. And it is an attitude in our culture that is permeating society right now. It's everywhere. Bering County, we are very image conscious. We're addicted to looking good and to having things that we think make us look good, in part because we have been told by everybody on a regular basis that we are worth it and we deserve it, and all that really matters is me. In Psalm 36 and verse 2, it speaks of the narcissist attitude when it says, "In their own eyes, they flatter themselves too much to detect or hate their own sin." The NLT said, "In their blindness, in their conceit," that is in their pride, in their self-inflated view of themselves, in their self-importance, they can't see how wicked they really are. They think, if I feel good, well, then I And if I look good, then I must be good, when in fact, there can be very wicked and not good. So what are the effects with its preoccupation on our society right now? What are these three things causing in our society right now? Because they permeate the culture today. What's happening? What are the effects of that? Three things. Number one, you see disintegrating families and marriages. A study was done nationally on America's search for self-fulfillment. Hundreds of people were interviewed across the country, and the study concluded that among those most devoted to their own self-fulfillment, not surprisingly, were those who were having the most problem in their marriage. One example was a young mother of four small children who went back to work seeking because she wanted self-fulfillment, and so she went back to work seeking fulfillment in her life. She said, I thought it was what I needed, but now I feel cheated. There's something wrong. It just does, but I can't seem to put my finger on it. It's not by accident that among my generation, the me generation, divorce rates soared to one out of every two marriages. Another effect of this preoccupation with self is superficial relationships. Because when I'm preoccupied with me, yeah, I don't really have a lot of time for personal closeness because I'm too busy focused on my goals, and therefore I can't afford to let a relationship interfere with my path, my plans, or my career. The result is we have a lot of very lonely people today who are dealing with frustration and despair and depression. Because if you put yourself at the center of your own universe, pretty soon after a while, your world is going to become meaningless because self-centeredness never satisfies. It leaves a bitter taste or an aftertaste in your mouth at some point. Why? It's because there's more to life than just you. Somebody say, man, there is more to life than just you. And when you make you the center of your life, when you make you your own little God, pretty soon you start to feel like life is pointless. I watched a movie one time where one of the characters of the movie would stand up in front of the mirror every morning, and he would look in the mirror and he would say, I'm the master of my universe. I'm the master of my universe. I'm the master of my universe, to try to get himself psyched up for the challenges of the day. That's like a lot of self-help stuff that we are hearing in our culture right now. He thought he was the master of his universe until he was in an automobile accident and his world fell apart. And then he realized, in reality, he didn't have control of anything. Point is, we all want to be our own little God, but we are not God. Satan, the first thing that he said to Adam and Eve was, eat this and you can be like God. You'll be God. You'll be like God. The modern isms of our day are in reality not modern at all. They're really just an old bunch of lies. They're as old as man. There's nothing new about any of them. You can be your own God? Satan's been saying that for years because he knows the propensity of human beings is that we want to be our own God. But the fact is, when we make ourselves the center of the universe, eventually our world crumbles because we cannot control everything around us. So we realize at some point that we need a higher power, a greater authority, a focus, a North Star, a moral compass to give our life meaning and significance. Proverbs 28, verse 25, selfish people cause trouble, but you will live a full life if you trust in the Lord. Selfishness only brings trouble. Now, if that's true, and it is, then what is the solution to self-centeredness? How today can we counteract this constant influence of our culture, a culture where everything around us is telling us to think only of ourselves? And by the way, even Christians can get caught up in this. It is easy to be influenced by the world and to begin to think only of ourselves. Yet selfishness is what is bringing on most of the problems that we face in our families and in our world. So what's the antidote? With a solution for a Christian to self-centeredness. Well, there are three of them. There are three of them, ladies and gentlemen. You might want to write these down because these will bless you now and in the future. Number one, I've got to have strong relationships. I've got to build strong relationships. Get interested in other people. Okay? Do that. Cultivate some friendships. Because you need other people in your life, if for no other reason, to give you balance so that you will not become self-focused and then self-centered. You need relationships. You say, well, I'm a busy man. I don't have time for relationships in my life, preacher. Well, then you're too busy, and you need to make time for relationship for your own psychological and spiritual health. We need other people in our lives. Listen to 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 11. Remember that in God's plan, men and women need each other. The NIV said, woman is not independent of man, nor is man independent of woman. So for all the feminists who think we don't need men, and for the male chauvinist who thinks I don't need women, they're both wrong. For if it were not for men, there would be no feminist. And if it were not for women, there wouldn't be no chauvinist. Every woman came from a man, and every man came from a woman. The Bible says we need one another. Somebody say amen. All these liberation movements that are running around the country today spouting their ideology, at their very core, all of them are rooted in selfishness. It's, I want to do my own thing and forget the rest of you. Caring about somebody is the fastest way to get your focus off of yourself. So build some relationships in your life. Work at it. That takes time. That takes work. Work at building relationships. I remember when I first fell in love with my wife, and I've been married now 34 years. We've been together 36 years. Somebody say amen. Amen. I remember when I first fell in love with my wife, Kara, the only person I could think of was her. I don't remember even thinking about myself. It was, what can I do for her? How can I please her? How can I make her happy? What can I buy her? Why? Because I was in love with her. Still am. But I was in love with her and not myself. That's what love does. It gets your focus off of yourself and puts it onto another person. So it makes you a giver and not a taker. One of the purposes of the church is to help you to build relationships into your life so that you're not selfish. It's called fellowship. And the Bible said in Ephesians 2:19 that we are no longer strangers to God and foreigners to heaven. We are members of God's very own family, citizens of God's country, and we belong in God's household with every other Christian. So I want you to hear me and hear me clearly. You're a member of the family. We are a part of a family. If you're another male and you're a Christian, then you and I are brothers in Christ. If you're a you're my sister in Christ, if you're a female, no matter what, we are brothers and sisters in Christ. We are a member of a family. Somebody say amen. Now, I know some families are dysfunctional, but the church was never meant to be that way. Come on now. Okay? We are to love on each other. We are to understand that we're in a family together. I believe that one of the antidotes that we need in a selfish society is a church family. Everybody needs a church family. Why? Because you need a place where you can belong, become, and be all that God wants you to be. God never called us to be lone rangers out here. He didn't. And when we don't have relationships, or we get too busy for them, we tend to focus on ourselves and see life only from our point of view. We only see ourselves. And so the best place to build relationships is in a church. Hebrews 10:24 and the first half of 25 says in the New International Version, let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day, that's the day of Christ coming back, approaching. The Contemporary English Version said, don't give up meeting together. You need to get together with other Christians in order to encourage each other. Don't just come and attend. Come and participate and belong. It's accountability. And accountability helps keep us on track. We need to come and encourage one another. That's why we do small groups, so that you can get to know people and other people can get to know you, and we can support each other and help each other and love each other and pray for each other, encourage one another. It's for your own emotional and spiritual health. You need these kind of relationships in your life. It's also one of the reasons that unless you are physically unable to attend, I don't believe that television church should be an alternative to the real thing. If you cannot attend church due to an illness or a physical disability, or you're out of town or something like that, that's one thing. Live streaming church has its place and purpose, but TV church should never be a substitute for coming to real church. Somebody say amen, right? We should come together. It makes it, because not coming makes us passive people. You get up in your PJs, you turn on the message, you turn on the service, you watch the service, you flip it off, and then you do whatever it is you want to do. It requires no involvement or no commitment at all. You don't have to interact with anybody. And one of the benefits of the church is the interaction that we have with other people. It's where we come and we get to build strong Christian relationship. And that is the first antidote to counteracting what the culture is saying today, to live for yourself. Here's the second antidote to self-centeredness. You've got to start to give yourself away. Write that down in your outline if you would, please. To defeat self-centeredness, you've got to give yourself away. What am I talking about here? I'm talking about through some kind of service, ladies and gentlemen. It's called ministry. So we talked about fellowship, now we're in ministry. And I'm convinced that to be spiritually, emotionally healthy and balanced, that everybody, every Christian, needs some form of service that they are performing on a weekly, if not weekly, at least a regular basis, where they voluntarily give of themselves without expecting or receiving any personal benefit in return. You need it as a balance to what the culture is pushing against you or pushing on you. Seriously, I believe that everybody needs some place of service. We have what? 168 hours a week. God doesn't want you to use every one of those hours on yourself. So you need a place of service where you can learn to give yourself away. And maybe as a children's church teacher, maybe as a care visitation, maybe as a community volunteer, or any of the other number of ministries that we have going on in our church. Just something where you can give yourself away, a portion of yourself, without any personal benefit in return. And you need to do that for your own health, for your own benefit, and for your own balance. Ephesians 2:10 says, "For we are God's masterpiece. We are God's workmanship. We are God's handiwork. We are God's creation. We are God's design, and He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we who are anew in Christ Jesus can do good things that He planned for us," look here now, "long ago." Man, that's good. See, God has given us new lives in Christ, and we should spend those new lives helping other people. There are so many people today that in our culture today that have an identity crisis. They don't know who they are. That's what we see driving the culture today. Many, many people don't know who they are. They're asking all kinds of questions like, who am I? Where did I come from? Where am I going? Why am I here? What am I supposed to do with my life? Well, the Bible answers those questions and says, long ago, God planned that we are in Christ should spend our lives helping other people. That's what God wants you to do with your life. God wants you to serve Him and help other people, which means you are never going to find fulfillment in your life in living just for yourself. You will only find self-fulfillment in giving your life away to help other people. A number of years ago, the Salvation Army held a conference where they were expecting the founder of the Salvation Army, General William Booth, to come and speak at the conference. But he got sick and couldn't come. So he promised to send a telegram from London and the day and lay out his plan and his vision and his direction and goals and objectives for the organization for the next decade. When the conference began, received the telegram, the convention center was packed with people. Everybody was anticipating what Mr. Booth was going to say about the vision and direction of the Salvation Army for the next decade. But when the man opened the telegram, a frown fell over his face because there was only one word on the message: others. That's it, folks. We are in Jesus Christ, should be focused on others. I want to ask you this: what drives your life? What drives your life? Is it money, success, status, influence, your own comfort or personal recreation? The pursuit of those things, none of them are necessarily bad in and of themselves, but they ultimately will not satisfy you. They